Thank you. Thank you. देवादि देव तुम तेरू previous births, to have lived at the same period of time as our Guru Nanak dwelt on this earth, and feel blessed to have had his darshana. I have no merit otherwise to speak about it. When I think of those days, so many waves of memories abound within me. Swami Vivekananda began his speech at Jatna Hindu College 120 or more years ago with the words, "Subject is vast, time is short." Swami himself, who had been present at that meeting, has mentioned this. Likewise, it is very difficult to select what to say and what to do in these reminiscences. Gowned in a pure white cotton cloth, the magnetic eyes that would seem to penetrate the depth of our soul with benevolence, the white silky beard and knotted hair all appear in my mind's eyes. Holding an umbrella under his armpits, he would walk the streets of Jatna with a small group of devotees following him. Those traveling in vehicles would either stop and disembark or slow down while passing him. While we lived in Jatna, every Thursday, my parents, along with us children, would go to his simple thatched one-room abode for his lesson. We are taught to respect and revere our mother, father, guru, and God respectively. Our first acquaintance on this earth is our mother, who introduces our father to us. The duty of the father is to seek the proper guru to instill in us a higher understanding of the meaning of life itself. Though material progress is necessary in practical life, one has to rise above that for inner peace and harmony. That is imparted to us by a great guru, by his life and teachings. The belief is that God is represented in human form by a Sadguru. That discernment of identifying and surrendering to a Sadguru also happens by the grace of God. Avan Arulale Avantai Manangu, says Manindavasar. Swami interacted with the thousands of devotees according to their individual levels of understanding and needs. Be it prime ministers, supreme court judges, street sweepers, vendors in markets, old or young, all were equally. Gold and mud were alike in his view. As a true ascetic, he did not save or accumulate anything for himself. All offerings were distributed immediately to those present. As he was a Jivan Mukta, one who had realized the universal soul above and beyond the strictures and boundaries of formalized religions, people from different faiths and countries and all walks of life came to him. He would instruct by quoting from their own scriptures and encourage them to follow the paths laid down for them. Although he possessed great siddhis, he preferred not to publicize them and lived as part of this world and yet above it all, not fully understood by the devotees with different levels of spiritual experiences who followed him. Many others, even those who lived in the vicinity of his humble abode, did not realize or appreciate the greatness of this sage. He chased away many who came for material or personal gains or to test him. Their egos would not submit to his scoldings and strong language, but some returned repeatedly, quashing their egos, sensing that such strong language was to test and purify their inner selves. That a great sense of peace pervaded one when seated in his magnetic presence is a personal experience. There was no need to ask for anything. He always knew. Even at the time of Swami's youth, when many did not know or approach him, both my maternal and paternal grandfathers were among the few who recognized the dimension of his spiritual luminosity. Therefore, our homes were also among those blessed by his visits. When we were living in Hatta, my parents heard that Swami was staying at the residence of a devotee in Peradeniya. They took me with them. I was 4 years old then. I remember vividly Swami seated in an armchair, calling me and saying, "Come here, I will teach you a song. You must repeat it every day." Standing close to him, my head was slightly higher than the arm of his chair. I remember him writing in large letters 10 lines of the song, which ended with the words, we, the absolute we lack nothing, we. Naam, 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 nala naam, naam, naam. Namakuru kura vilay, naam, naam, naam. We have at all times no needs. To this mind, this intellect, this thought, to this changing and destructible body that encompasses all of this has many needs, desires and grievances. But the timeless soul, Atma, does not dissolve. Therefore, there are no needs for that which is indestructible. Understanding this profound philosophy took a very long time, but to realize it totally and reach that high spiritual elevation will require many births for me. And yet, one has to take the first step towards any goal. And this is what our Gurunadar, by his incomparable tenderness, conveyed to me. He is the divinity that I have been blessed to behold and to whom I still offer my prayers. My father was working in Jaffna when I was 8 years old. We were living in a house in Beechro, close to town. At that time, I contracted enteric flu, suffering from a very high temperature. My uncle, who was an Ayurvedic physician and a well-known Western medical specialist, tried their best to treat me, and yet the temperature did not subside. In that extremely weak condition, I cried to my parents, "I want to see Swami. Take me to him." My mother thought that was the dying wish of her child and started sobbing. My father was equally upset and did not know what to do. At that moment, Swami, who was in the vicinity of Mallapuram village, stopped a devotee who arrived in a car and asked to be driven to my father's house. An hour later, he arrived at our house. "Why did you call me?" he asked me, and put me on my forehead and told my parents nothing wrong with her and left. There are many similar incidents. As soon as we were married, we went to UK for 3 years, where my husband completed his specialization as an orthopedic surgeon and on our return was given a post in Kalapur General Hospital. My parents were in Jaffna. I was expecting my first child and came over to Jaffna to stay with my parents for the confinement. Then one day, someone came in a highly agitated state, saying that a cow had pushed Swami to the ground. My parents immediately rushed to Kopparambai. A number of devotees who were already assembled there, including Dr. Kandaratnam, Dr. Ramanathan, and Dr. Guru Swami, they said, as the nearly 90 years old Swami's hip bone was fractured, it was preferable to get a specialist over to treat it. At the time, there were no orthopedic surgeons in Jaffna. So they phoned my husband and summoned him. The Minister of Health then was Mr. A.P. Jayasurya, who was an ardent devotee of Swami. He directly ordered approval for the necessary surgical instruments to be taken from the Kalam General Hospital and permission for my husband to take the flight the following day. But still, I was worried as I felt clearly that unless Swami wished to benefit by the operation and treatment, anything could happen on the operating day. As a young wife whose husband's career was just beginning, if his surgery to this great siddha had negative results, his professional reputation and future would be at stake was my worry. I did not disclose my apprehensions to anyone. That night, Swami appeared in my dream and told me, "Do not worry, I will live for another 3 years. Exactly 3 years later, he attained Mahasamadhi. A great yogi such as he, who could foretell the future and knew the past and present, would have known that the cow he had nurtured would be the cause of his physical suffering. After the surgery, he endured a great deal of pain. Then he told a concerned devotee, "This is something I brought from birth. Suffering is a boon. Wise people will happily accept this. Others, by their ignorance, make a great issue of it." According to the great precept, Apovo Murinda Kanya, everything is preordained. It is clear that even yogis have to fulfill their karma. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa and Ramana Maharshi suffered from cancer, but they distinctly separated their bodies from their inner selves and accepted the pain. Although he was above language, race and creed, he predicted the tribulations that his country would be plunging. When devotees went to him in distress during the 1958 racial riots that targeted the Tamils, he said, "Not just this, there will be more destructions to come. People are going to suffer immensely without food. Many will leave the country." All those born on this earth as human beings have at least a small spark in them that is longing to rise to a higher spiritual level. It is because of this yearning that people, according to their different religions, follow the rituals and precepts ordaining them and undertake pilgrimages to holy places of worship. There are also many who prefer instead to serve those in need. Selfless service to mankind is service to God is their creed. This is Sivatundu. Swami has mentioned this in deeper terms in his many songs and sayings. Our dear father had been trying from an early age to improve his spiritual progress. He would rise at dawn, pray, and pray and meditate, and then if there was no time in the evening due to his work and social commitments, late at night too he would not go to sleep without praying. To attain a higher spiritual level was an extremely important matter to him, despite his family life and other worldly commitments. Many of Swami's devotees had similar aspirations. "Make hair while the sun shines," it is said. So while Swami was living, many wanted to benefit from his luminous presence. Father would listen carefully to Swami's sayings and would come home and write it all down in notebooks. I have a couple of these still with me, dated 3862. It's as follows. "While at the ashram, I was for a moment thinking of my spiritual backwardness. Swamiji looked at me and said, 'In the same tree, there are leaves, flowers, fruits in different stages of development. This is not a matter to be worried about. It is in the order of things.' Another time, 'You must not think of difficulties in advance and prepare yourself to face them. You should take life as it comes and treat difficulties as a matter of routine. God is always with you. This is the greatest news I have for you.'" Some of the sayings are published in the book Words of Our Master. Some have not been included in that. Some have not been included in that, written in the back of a small book which is of dating from 1947 to 1969. A few of those advices to father: work for work's sake, love for love's sake. The world is a big temple to which all kinds of pilgrims come, good, bad, etc. We should concentrate on the worship and not pick holes about others' doings. The world is sacred and secret. Constant occupation keeps off temptation. Constant meditation leads to liberation. Name and fame are like a mirage in the desert. Work goes on. No human being is responsible for it. Do not boast that you have achieved this or that. Things happen by themselves. Do not create anything." To each one, it has been measured, each according to past actions. This is unalterable. One should realize this and do what comes his way. He will then be happy. If the idea is firmly rooted in their mind, in the mind, even if we make a mistake and get involved in happiness and sorrow, we will come back to the point. There are some more of Swamiji's sayings Kala has faithfully jotted down in that small notebook. But there is this incident written down by him in 1969, 5 years after Swamiji's Mahasamadhi. He rarely, if ever, divulged his very personal experiences with Swami, always saying, sacred is secret, not something to be talked about for public consumption. But fortunately, he wrote down in this notebook an experience which is remarkable. At this time, he happened to be permanent secretary to the Ministry of Lands, Irrigation and Power, which is relevant to this incident. There was a strike called by the electricity department island-wide. The government was not willing to accede to that, to their demands. Kala was sympathetic to the trade unions and was very worried. This is what he wrote. 1969, September 9th of 23rd, 24th. During the anxious days following the strike in the 13th of the electrical department, clear green, a message was sent that Swamiji wished to see. When I went, he was lying on a couch with a large number of disciples standing reverently close by. As I reached the bedside, Swamiji turned once on the couch, got up, then touched his mouth with his forefinger and wrote some mystic symbols on my tongue. It was most awe-inspiring. I dreamt that Swamiji was seated in a D.O.H. chair. I fell at his lotus feet and worshipped him. On the 24th, I met the Prime Minister at Woodlands, along with others, when important decisions were taken. 28th September, dream. Swamiji appears as the very embodiment of purity. The very darshan gave the aura of indescribable purity. He had something to eat. He then said, "We must take the initiative and speak to them." This was the time the electricity department union were trying to get an opportunity to have a conference to break the stalemate. This command was clearly for my guidance. I took steps to arrange for a conference on the following day, he concludes. I personally remember that everything was settled amicably at the time. Although he never discussed this dream with any of us at any time, this clearly shows that these great souls, even though they leave their physical body, they are with us at all times when we invoke their guidance. My father suffered from acute asthmatic attacks from his childhood. Western medicines and specialists had no cure for him. Ayurvedic medicine also seemingly did not help. Then one day, Swami, in his compassion, personally went to my uncle's Ayurvedic dispensary, asked to be given certain medicines. This he gave to my father, asking him to follow the instructions. After that, father was free of this agonizing malady for 30 years. Finally, a strong attack of asthma took him away from us. To an ordinary person like me, what seems is that self-realized souls are beyond time. Even though they meet their physical body, they are still sublimely within us, pervading our hearts and minds. And when we fervently pray to them, obstacles and afflictions have been removed or dissolved and granted peace and succor. This is my personal experience of our Lokananda. And Swami has left to us a great treasure trove, which are the sayings and songs in Nanchin Benin of his thoughts. Daily study of this answers the many queries that arise in our troubled minds. With a clear mind, sit and meditate for 10 or 15 minutes. One will be granted one's wish, he has said. Even though we may not be able to fully understand the philosophical depth of the meaning of the song, yet the fact that they have been uttered by him, who did, permeates and inspires the mind and grants peace. He has said, while wearing the vibhuti daily, to say these words of the Bhagavad. Nam Shivaya Vata, Narandaya Vata, Imet Kodun, Indir Indarandaya Vata. Praise be to Shiva. Praise be to the feet of the Lord, who does not leave my heart even for a nanosecond. Singing his songs and following even a little of his messages, we would like for nothing.